Shabbat Shalom. It is wonderful to return home to Durham from another one of my homes, Israel. And I am so grateful to our community and its leadership for giving me time in Israel for renewal and study at the Hartman, at the Shalom Hartman Institute. Our studies this summer was Why Zionism? In which we studied the approaches of seven different scholars to why the state of Israel should continue to matter to American Jews in the 21st century. This morning, I want to share a small part of Yossi Klein Halevi's answer to that question and how that answer relates to our Torah portion from this morning and to Tisha B'Av, which begins tonight. Klein Halevi reminded our group that while Judaism and celebrates God as the creator of the natural world, our tradition's perhaps most daring assertion is not only that God created the universe, but that God acts in history. Our foundational story is the Exodus, in which God cares about our suffering in slavery, fights on our behalf to redeem us from Pharaoh and plants us in the land of Israel. It was an audacious move of the rabbis throughout history to say, don't just look at history, but look at Jewish history to find God's fingerprints. Because throughout Jewish history, we have always been one of the smallest and weakest and most persecuted and hated peoples in the world. At various times, Christianity and Islam would argue that their own power was evidence of God's rejection of Judaism. While Jews stubbornly said, just wait, our time will come. We are serving a prison sentence of sorts, but we're going to come back. That theology is embedded in the rabbinic understanding of this morning's Torah portion, in the prayers of Lev Shalem, kind of, and in our observance of Tisha B'Av. The Torah portion begins this morning, El HaDevarim Asher Diber Moshe Kol Yisrael. These are the words that Moses addressed to all of Israel on the other side of the Jordan, and then continues with the list of place names, Bamibar, Ba'arava, Mulsup, Ben Paradu, Ben Tofe, V'Lavan, V'Chatzero, V'Dizahav. Rashi, quoting an older Midrashic tradition, explains that the mention of each of these place names is a veiled rebuke of the Jewish people's past sins. So, for example, when Moses says Dizahav, we should hear that as Dizahav, enough gold, and as a reference to the sin of the golden calf. The logic of Moses's reading of these, of reading Moses's words as words of rebuke derives from how the rabbis understood Jewish history. The rabbis did not blame the destruction of the temples on the Babylonians or on the Romans. They didn't blame the Spanish Inquisition on the Spanish. Those peoples, according to the rabbis, were instruments through which God punished us for our sins. In the traditional Musaf Amidah, we say a phrase, Mipnei chateinu galinu me'aretzenu, that we have been exiled from our land because of our sins. I said kind of in Lev Shalem because Musaf, the Lev Shalem, offers up a different set of readings that precisely goes in a different direction from this theology. But in this traditional theology, our suffering is our own fault, but it's not only bad news because God continues. What that means is that God continues to care for us and about us, and that one day we will be forgiven and we will be redeemed. Klein Halevi, in his session, pointed out that in 1945, after the Shoah, this theology of sin, punishment, and forgiveness became untenable for most Jews. He argued that the Shoah fundamentally challenged the credibility of the story that we told ourselves for 2,000 years. And that we were confronted with, what we were confronted with in that moment was a challenge that if we were to ignore the religious challenge of Auschwitz, we would be ceding history to the demonic. I can't go over his whole argument in this setting, but we looked at a passage from a 2014 book called A World Without Jews by the University of Massachusetts Amherst professor Alon Confino, in which Confino argues that when we see the essence of Kristallnacht as the destruction of shops or even the burning of synagogues, we are actually missing its deeper significance. For 2,000 years, Confino points out, when Christian violence erupted against Jews, they would commit acts of violence against Jews. They might even burn the Talmud as they did in 13th century Paris, but never did they desecrate Torah scrolls. Because those Torah scrolls contained sacred scripture for Christians. On Kristallnacht, Confino points out, German Christians rolled Torahs into the streets. Children were encouraged to ride their bicycles over them, and the scrolls themselves were burned. For a Christian society to burn Torah scrolls en masse, argued Confino, was part of a larger program not only of training the German people to cross moral red lines and accustom them to doing so, but actually a program of de-Judaizing Christianity. In fact, in 1939, George Bertram founded something in Germany called the Institute for the Study and Elimination of Jewish Influence on German Church Life. It was dedicated to the study and the elimination of Jewish influence on German Christianity and the quote-unquote positive task of understanding the Christian German being and the organization of pious German life based on this knowledge. Confino argues that Kristallnacht should actually not be called Kristallnacht, the night of the broken glass, but should be called the night of desecrated scrolls, because it was part of a Nazi war against the God of Israel. The Nazis sought to prove that the God of Israel was powerless and that the invisible God of Israel actually did not exist. Auschwitz, he argues, was an inversion of the story that we told ourselves for 2,000 years. We believed that we were chosen by God, but in fact, we were chosen by the Nazis for destruction. We believed in a future ingathering of Jews in the land of Israel while the Nazis were gathering Jews for death and final destruction. We believed in a future in which the world would be filled with the knowledge of God while the Nazis sought to fill the world with knowledge of God's absence. Halevi argued that in 1945, Jews needed what he called a mythic counterweight to the theological challenge of Auschwitz. And that Zionism argued, that Zionism offered this mythic counterweight. He pointed out that while there is no solution, no answer theologically to Auschwitz, that by implementing a Jewish redemptive fantasy, the ingathering of Jews in our land, that Jews could hold on to the possibility that maybe God was not out of the picture of Jewish history, that maybe there was still some credibility to the God of Israel. Halevi grew up in Borough Park, New York, and remembers that in the Haredi shtiebel that his father attended in the 1960s, nobody davened. The Rebbe davened, but the survivors who comprised the population of this shtiebel talked about business. They visited with each other, but they would not pray. Even though secular Zionism had no interest in saving the God of Israel. Ben-Gurion, quite the opposite, thought that secular Zionism was burying the God of Israel. Halevi's father told him after the Shoah, "I stopped praying because God didn't deserve my prayer. After 1967, I started praying to God again." He admitted, Halevi admitted, that this approach is, in his words, theological dynamite. It can, and it has, led to ultra-nationalist triumphalism. If the state is part of God's plan, then nothing becomes off limits. And the Hartman Institute, where he made this argument, was founded in many ways to push back against those very tendencies in the state of Israel. But he argued Judaism is a religion of history, and we cannot ignore the Shoah and cannot ignore the existence of a sovereign Jewish state in the land of Israel for the first time after 2,000 years of exile. A religion of history cannot ignore the mythic. What we have to do is to rein in the mythic, struggle to keep it from going wild. The great Haredi heresy of the past 75 years has been to try and assert an ahistorical Judaism, a rejection of modernity, a freezing of anything Jewish after 1939. The conclusion that the Haredi community drew about modernity after Auschwitz was, not only does this prove that the non-Jewish world will never accept Jews, but why in the world would we ever want to be part of something like that? And so they began a process of self-ghettoization. Zionism, and in similar ways, American Jewry, went in a different direction, accepting that Auschwitz was part of modernity, but not defined by it. Zionism, in Halevi's works, goes for broke and offered another chance for the Jewish people to dream in history. The prophet Zechariah foretold a day when the fast of the fourth, the fast of the fifth, the fast of the seventh, the fast of the 10th months will be for the house of Judah for joy and gladness and festivals, therefore love, truth, and peace. The fourth month in this verse is the month of Tammuz. The fifth is the month of Av, referring to the Tisha B'Av, which begins tonight. I myself no longer observe the minor fasts associated with the destruction of Jerusalem, because I believe the time in which we are living with the modern state of Israel make those fasts unnecessary. But I will be fasting tonight and tomorrow, because Tisha B'Av is not just about our physical exile from the land, but about God's exile from the land and from us. I am incredibly grateful to be alive at this time in Jewish history, with a strong state of Israel and the extraordinary blessings of security and freedom that are offered by America, but there is still much brokenness in the world. Israel and America are unfinished promises. Israel's occupation of the Palestinian people continues to be a moral stain. America is a place of unfathomable wealth where people go hungry, where affordable healthcare is an oxymoron, where antisemitism and racism thrive, where the foundations of democracy feel insecure, and where, while I was gone, women's access to safe abortion, as is sometimes required by Jewish law, is now under siege. God may be present in history, but Tisha B'Av is a time to mourn the many, many places and times in our contemporary world where God seems very absent, because the ideals of justice and righteousness are so far away. I wish all of us a meaningful fast, if we are able, and a Tisha B'Av as a time of reflection about how it is that we can recommit ourselves to the process of bringing God's light into a world very much in need. Shabbat shalom.
Yashkawa.